Which are the essential tools in an app? Which one do I use and how am I organized? A video for all which are curious about how it looks behind the camera. Maybe you discover something you can use for your own work? Pretty YouTubers, here is the guy with the Swiss accent, with a new episode and fresh ideas around sensors and microcontrollers. How time passes. It is now nearly 3 years ago when I started my channel. Back then, this room was still the office of my small company. This changed a lot and quite fast. Today I want to share some learnings with you, my valued viewers, who made this possible. My room is small. It is around 5 times 3 meters or 16 by 10 feet. And it is packed with a lot of unnecessary things, if you ask my wife. It is in the basement without a view to the outside, which helps the concentration on my work. It has 2.5 stations for work. 2 for me and 1 which is used temporarily by Marvin the trainee. 1 station is for computer work and 1 for lab work. Let's start with a lab. The 4 essential devices here are a multimeter, the power supply, the soldering station and the oscilloscope. All instruments except the oscilloscope are chosen to be good enough for my experiments and according to a good price performance ratio. The power supply is very old and I bought it secondhand. I have an ESD mat which is connected to earth and helps to protect my desk from dirt and burns and my parts from static electricity. The next 2 essential things are... No, not Dishka. She just came down because she wanted to say hello to you. The next 2 essential things in my lab are the drawers and the waste basket. Both very close to me when I work here. The top drawer contains the most important tools. Pliers, including the vital wire stripper. Then scissors and tweezers. In the next compartment, various screwdrivers and in the last one, calipers. One for right-handed and one for left-handed people. The same applies to the scissors. By the way, as you might know, I'm left-handed. In the next 2 drawers you find mostly DuPont wires. These are the wires used in most of my projects. The topic wires would not be complete without adding my empty shells used to create custom connectors with standard DuPont wires, and my crimper used to create custom length DuPont wires. Both are covered in other videos. Just follow the tips and tricks playlist. In this drawer you also find pin headers and double-sided tape, both essential tools in my lab. The next drawer contains material for my addiction to wireless systems, connectors, antennas and adapters. The next drawer contains USB and other cables as well as some USB meters. The last drawer contains mainly breadboards. I have many of them because I store most projects including the breadboards. The other drawers do not contain essential materials, so I skip them for today. A few other things are used nearly every day. The hot glue guns, one for black and one for transparent glue, solder flux and alcohol, compressed air and solder. If you turn the compressed air can upside down, it creates a freezing stream which can be used to cool hot glue fast. Then we come to the storage of projects. This was a significant breakthrough in organizing my lab. I use small plastic boxes, mostly bought at IKEA, to store all my projects and some other things which belong together, like ESP32 or LoRa boards. This is one of the biggest time savers. I recently had to add some additional space for that purpose. As you see, it would be much easier for me if I would be taller. Another essential piece of my equipment is my binocular. I would never go back to a USB microscope. Why? Because with this binocular, you can see in three dimensions. You look in the direction of your hands, which is very important for coordination, and you have a big distance between your parts and the lenses. All three indispensable if you want to solder SMD parts. Even the cheapest binocular is better than any USB microscope because of these features. I use LED lamps controlled by these small PIR sensors connected to my Raspberry Pi Zero, which runs Node-RED. Today I will not talk a lot about my milling machine because it is very rarely used these days. Why? First, because I have a 3D printer. Secondly, because it usually creates a lot of dust. And third, because I can buy cheap double-sided PCBs and do not need to produce my own anymore. By the way, I do not suggest to place a milling machine in a lab. It better fits into a workshop. I am sometimes asked about good books for electronics, and I have to admit, nearly all these books here are from my former life and do not cover electronics. I show you some of them that you see where I come from. The first one is Tracy Kidder's The Soul of a New Machine. This is the mother of all books on electronics engineers in my view. Then the book about Kelly Johnson and his Skunkworks team who built all famous American spy planes like the SR-71 Blackbird or the Stealth Bomber. And the book on the guys around Robert Oppenheimer who made the atomic bomb. All vast projects with lots of brilliant engineers in charge. Not to forget The Goal, which was written in 1984 and still is the best book for each young engineer. It forever changed how I think. The Heart of the Enterprise, written by Stafford Beer in 1979, a very complicated but mind-boggling book for people who are interested in organizational design. It also helped me a lot in advancing my understanding of the world. The last one is the biography of Ken Olsen, the guy who founded the best company I worked for, Digital Equipment Corporation. The only two electronic books you find in my lab are The Art of Electronics and this new one on debugging I bought on the recommendation of a viewer. The rest of my knowledge comes from the internet. It is faster and broader. You also see I love books, and it is nearly impossible for me to throw one away. Next comes the storage of small parts. I use two concepts for that. These little drawers and these boxes. Both have their advantages and disadvantages. Boxes are great for my beloved assortments. Because I cannot tell you what I will do tomorrow or even next week, I have to have many parts readily available. This is the reason I bought quite some assortments over time. Very advisable for any decent maker, because they are usually quite cheap. The last machine in my lab, and also the newest one, is my Prusa MK3 printer. When I got it, I was slightly disappointed, because it does not look spectacular at all. Most of the parts are 3D printed, which leaves the impression of a project rather than a professional machine. I could not have been more wrong. This is an incredible machine and worth every cent. Yes, it is costly compared to other 3D printers. Why was I wrong? Because 3D printing for me is not a hobby. It is a necessity and I want that it works without any problems. This is exactly what this small bugger does. It prints high quality objects. What else? With my old printer, I had to cover the aluminium heat bed with Captain tape. And I used, as I still use, hairspray to keep the parts on the heated bed. Then I had to use such an instrument to get the parts from the heat bed. Unfortunately, quite often together with pieces of the Captain tape, which costed me more than an hour of work to replace it, including the two helping hands of my wife. Here I take this spring metal carrier out of the printer and bend it. Done. Extremely useful. Next, ABS. I was never able to print ABS on my printer because of warping of the edges. With this printer, it is no problem at all to print ABS. Next, it has an auto-leveling feature, and you can forget this manual auto-leveling forever. And the last one, it has a feature to stop the print in the middle of printing. This is an advantage for me as a YouTuber, because if I have to record my voice, I can stop the printer for this time and continue later. The second advantage is valid for everybody. If your filament roll runs empty, the printer stops and you can add a new roll. So you can use 100% of your filament. Before, I lost a lot of filament because I either did not start the print with the last amount on the roll, or it finished before the part was completed and I had to begin again. Let's continue with the second workstation, my computer. I use three 27-inch monitors and still think I could use one more. My computer is homemade and I upgrade it from time to time using new parts like SSD drives instead of magnetic drives, or recently a new graphics card. As you can see, I use Windows. Why? Because I always used Windows and I do not know Mac or Linux very well. The research, programming and cutting is done here. Let's look at my favorites list. You find here the usual office stuff, including Skype, which I use for communication with partners. Then you find PuTTY and YAT, two terminal emulators. Then Eagle, which I use for PCB design. The next four tabs are used to create my YouTube videos. FlashAir Downloader to download files from my camera, Audacity, PowerDirector and Movavi for screen recording. Next, you see two editors, Atom and Notepad++. I use Notepad++ much more because it starts up faster. Then Evernote, an excellent tool for research. I use it mainly to clip pages in Chrome and assign keywords to it. This saves me a lot of time searching for info. I often also discover things I once clipped but forgot in the meantime. The best is I can store links even on my iPad, which I use outside my lab. Then Fusion 360 and Simplify 3D for designing and printing 3D models. I recently changed to Fusion 360 because it can be used for free also by you, my viewers. In the future, I intend also to share the design files, not only the STL files on Thingiverse. To program my microprocessors, I use the Arduino IDE and I have a few development boards right here. Usually I start with these boards as long as I do not need a lot of additional hardware. It is more convenient to have them right at my fingertips, if I have to push the reset button, for example. I like these ESP8266 boards and I also purchased these ESP32 boards. In my opinion, the one with a big USB is best for that purpose. Why do I love these big boards? Because they usually stay where I put them. I even glued some felt on the bottom to avoid scratches on my lovely table, which is, by the way, a table used for kitchens. This material, like most things in my lab, has an excellent price-performance ratio. This is also valid for the drawers, which come from the IKEA kitchen program. They are also good quality and I'm pretty sure they will live longer than I do. And here you see the screen for my Raspberries. I connect them via a HDMI switch and a wireless keyboard mouse combination. Like that, I always have the possibility to connect one or the other RPI to a screen and a keyboard. Most of the work, however, is done using SSH. Like that, I can copy-paste from one screen to another on my PC. Here you also see one of my projects, the button which creates MQTT messages. Here you see my primary video camera, and here my new camera. I was able to purchase it with the money given to me by my Patreons. It enables easy macro shots and its handling is very comfortable. And last but not least, my subscriber counter, which just passed 70,000. Incredible! Thank you all for your continued support. I hope and I try to do my best to create an electronics community. so feel free to write comments and share the videos with your colleagues who might be interested in joining us. I hope this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If true, please consider supporting the channel to secure its future existence. You find the links in the description. Thank you. Bye.